Rendering in Unreal Engine 5.6 just got better, but to get the best results, you need the right settings. In this video, I'll guide you through the updated render options that actually make a difference, so your final output looks clean, sharp, and cinematic. All right, here we are in Unreal Engine. In Unreal Engine 5.6, there's a new button that gives you access to both the Quick Render and the Movie Render queue. The Quick Render isn't meant for high-quality output, so I'm going to focus on the Movie Render queue settings I personally use for most of my renders. Now click on the Movie Render queue button. This will open the Movie Render queue window. If it doesn't show up, make sure the Movie Render queue plugins are enabled. Just go to Edit, Plugins, search for Movie Render queue, and enable both plugins. If Unreal asks you to restart, go ahead and restart the engine. Once you're ready, click on Unsave Config to open the render settings. Here we've got options like JPG sequence and deferred rendering. I'm going to delete the JPG sequence and add an EXR sequence instead. It gives the highest quality render. Next, we have the compression method. I've been using PIZ for a long time. It's a lossless format, so you don't lose any quality. You can choose a different option if you want, but I always go for the highest quality renders. Before we move on to the next setting, here's some good news for all creators. Unreal Engine now lets us render videos directly in MP4 format. No need for third-party plugins anymore. I'm adding this to my config so I can show you the render later. Click the plus button again and add anti-aliasing. First, check override anti-aliasing and set the method to none. You'll see an error at the bottom. Just ignore it, like some of you ignore the effort I put into these videos. Anyway, next we have spatial sample count and temporal sample count. If you're rendering a still scene and want a high quality image, you'll want to increase the spatial sample count. I'm setting it to 16 for this render. Now, if there's movement in your scene like camera animation or particles, then you'll need temporal sample count. You can set it to 16 for good quality, and if your scene is too complex, you can increase it. Also, make sure to set spatial sample count to 1, because spatial and temporal samples multiply during rendering. If both are too high, your render time can shoot up and take hours. I deleted anti-aliasing by mistake, so I added it back and set the spatial sample count to 16. Since my camera and scene are still, you can increase the samples, but keep in mind, it'll use more VRAM during rendering. Now check render warm-up frames. This makes Unreal run a few frames before the actual render starts, so everything like lighting, motion blur, and effects have time to settle. It helps avoid glitches or noise in the first few frames. I usually set both values to 64, but if you have a particle system in your scene, like Niagara, Cascade, or PIM particles, then consider increasing it to 128. Now go to the plus button again and add game overrides. This setting is used to make sure your render looks exactly like it does when you hit play in the viewport. It forces the engine to use the same game logic and settings during rendering, like post-processing, LODs, and any real-time effects. Go to the plus button again, and this time add high resolution. This option lets you render images at a much higher resolution than your actual screen size by breaking the frame into tiles and stitching them back together. It's really useful for super detailed shots or when you need ultra-sharp stills. Now the next thing we need to add is color output. If you're not planning to do color grading later, make sure disable tone curve is checked. It'll add some contrast and make the render look good straight out of Unreal. But if you are going to color grade in post, keep tone curve unchecked. All right, let's set up the color output now. First, we need to select a configuration source. I already have one set up, but let's create a new one so I can show you guys how it's done. Click on Open Color IO Configuration, and it'll open a new pop-up window. I already have an OCIO folder, but you can create one or save it anywhere in the content browser. You can name this config however you like. I'll name mine OCIO_tutorial. Now double-click on the circular icon, and it'll open a new window. In here, we need to add color spaces. Click the plus button twice to add the color spaces we need. For index 0, select Linear Rec 709 from the Utility category. And for index 1, select Aces CG from the Aces category. Now again, click the plus button twice on the desired display view section. On index 0, under the Rect 1886, Rec 709 display category, select Aces 1.0 SDR video. And on index 1, Under the sRGB display category, select ACE's 1.0 SDR video as well. Now click Save and then close the window. And finally, we can check Enable OCIO. Now set the transform source to linear rec.709 sRGB and the transform destination to ACE's CG. Now everything is set. And finally, we can move to the output section. Here we choose the output folder. And most importantly, set the output resolution. I'm choosing desktop to render the scene, but I'd recommend using a folder in a different directory. Now I'll set the resolution to 4K, but you can set it to any resolution you like, depending on your project. Our render settings are all set, so now let's save them as a preset. That way, we won't have to redo everything for each new project. If you want to use my preset, I'll leave a download link in the video description. Now I'll click Accept, and then start the render. First, it'll compile all the shaders, and then it'll start warming up the frames we set earlier. 64 frames in my case. You may have noticed that, in your case, the render preview and the Unreal Engine viewport look different. That's because of the color space. I'll show you how to set up the OCIO color space in the viewport so it matches the final render. Now I'm stopping the render just to keep things transparent with you. Now let's close the movie render queue. I already have OCIO display enabled, but to turn it on, click the lit button in the viewport and at the bottom you'll see OCIO display. When I disable it, the difference is noticeable. Now I'll enable it again and then select the OCIO config we just created. In the first slot, select linear rec.709 sRGB, and in the second slot, choose rec.1886 rec.709 display. And now you can see the colors in the viewport look similar to our render. Now our work in Unreal Engine is done. Let me show you the video we rendered in MP4 format, and after that, I'll show you how to import the EXR frame sequence into DaVinci Resolve. Since I only rendered 18 frames, the video is just about 1 second long. But as you can see, the render is high quality and perfect for color grading. All right, let's move over to DaVinci Resolve. I'm in the Media tab now, but first, let's move the render folder to a different directory because DaVinci Resolve doesn't let you access desktop folders from the Media tab. Now just drag the sequence into the media pool, then I'll switch to the Edit tab and drag it onto the timeline. The render looks nicely dark, just the way it shouldn't. There's one step left. Go to the Color tab now. Open the Effects panel from the top right corner, then just drag and drop ACE's transform onto our clip. Once you've done that, you'll see the ACE's version is set to 2.0. That's the latest one. If you're using an older version of DaVinci Resolve, you can choose ACE's 1.3 instead. Now for the next step, in Input Transform, select ACE's CG, and for Output Transform, select rec.709BT1886. Now our render looks exactly the same as it did in the Unreal Engine viewport. And from here, you're free to do color grading or anything else you like. And now you've learned the best render settings for your project. Without having to sit through 30 or 40 minute videos or deal with endless yapping. No hate to other YouTubers, but I believe things can be taught simply. And let's be real, time is money.